begin our conversation this evening by actually doing a quick history of the practice of Black History Month celebrations within the Catholic Church. For those of you who are familiar, remember that Black History Month actually began as Negro History Week in 1926. It was founded by Dr. Carter G. Woodson, who was the second African-American to earn a PhD in history from Harvard University. It was established as a way to institutionalize and popularize Black history in the nation at a time in which African-Americans were not necessarily seen as citizens and certainly not treated as such. Interestingly enough, Negro History Week began in the nation's Black schools, and certainly in the case of the Catholic Church, it began being celebrated in 1926, in the schools of the nation's Black Catholic sisters. Over the years, they sort of developed and designed very elaborate programs in Black history. And if you'll notice here in this photo, this is a photo from a Negro History Week celebration from 1946 in Washington, D.C., at St. Augustine's Church, which at the time was under the administration of the Albert Sisters of Providence. Interestingly enough, they not only celebrated Negro history as it was known then, but they also made a point to celebrate Black Catholic history. In the case of their students here, all of the young girls are dressed in the habits of the sisterhoods who ministered in the African-American community at the time. From the left, you see the habit of the Franciscan Sisters of Mill Hill, which was a community in England who had come to the United States in the early 19th century to minister in the African-American community. And then to the right is the habit of the Oblate Sisters of Providence, who are the nation's oldest historically Black sisterhood, which were founded in Baltimore, Maryland in 1828. To the right of that is the old oblate habit when they used to wear bonnets. And then to the next, to the right of them are the Sisters of the Holy Family, the nation's second successful community sisters. And then to the on our right is the habit of the Franciscan sisters, Franciscan families who moved here after Mary, which were founded in Savannah, Georgia in 1916, and then later resettled in Harlem, New York, where they remain today. And so it's interesting to start specifically, I think, with Sister Cora Marie, reminding ourselves of the history and the role of Black sisters in popularizing Black history within the Catholic Church. And I actually wanted to start with to tell you a story of how I actually met Sister Cora Marie. I think our relationship is going on now for 10 years. I think I've known her for 10 years. I first interviewed her back in 2009. But interestingly enough, I actually first learned of Sister Cora Marie when I was doing research as a graduate student in the archives of the Albert Sisters of Providence in Baltimore. And interestingly enough, I was in the file of a sister known as Sister Mary Paul Lee, who was Sister Cora Marie's aunt, and at the time I didn't really know the history. But as I was going through her congregational file, I was shocked when I learned that her aunt was actually the granddaughter of a slave who had worked for the Jesuits at Georgetown. And for me, it stuck out because I didn't know the history of the church and its slaveholding past. And I thought it was really interesting to think about how many of these young women who had those descendants or who had those lineages actually became sisters. And so I actually wanted to start, I guess, with your family's own history and to tell the story of William Lee, what you know about it. And then, of course, we can move on from there thinking about your family. So first off, what do you know about your family's history?
I don't know a whole lot about my great-grandfather, but my aunt, the Sister Mary Paul, was my mother's youngest sister, the Oblate Sister of Providence. She told me, and that was when I found out, that my great-grandfather, William Lee, had been a slave of the Jesuits at Georgetown, and my understanding is that he would drive the carriage, I guess, that took the priest to the Visitation Convent to say Mass for the Visitation Sisters. And the other thing that I know as remarkable is that his baptismal, those of his siblings, their baptismal records are in the Holy Trinity Church, the famous church in Georgetown where the president, the Catholic presidents went. That's where my great-grandfather's baptismal certificates are. Records are there. They did, from there, they moved into Philadelphia. So my grandfather that I met, my grandfather, John A. Lee, and his siblings church that enslaved my great-grandfather. And it's difficult, but the thing for me is that I can stay and I will remain in the church because I can change the church from within. If I'm outside of the situation, outside of the system, you can't change it because nobody will pay attention. But within the system, you do change it.
You know, as I was thinking about Georgetown, the administrators at Georgetown, as they go on and continue to create programs to be able to reckon with and atone for their own slaveholding past, one of the achievements, or one of the accomplishments of their own project and the Memory Project has been to rename some of the halls after at least one of them was the first man who was listed on the list of those who were sold to the South. And they also decided to rename one of the halls after an Oblate Sister of Providence, Anne Marie Beecraft, who was known in religion as Sister Mary Aloysius. And for a lot of people who do not know of the church's history of slavery, and particularly to think about this early history of African-American Catholics in the church, I think what was really, you know, special for me was to remember that indeed so much of early American Catholic history is African-American history, and so much of early African-American history is actually Catholic history, to remind us that there are two transnational stories of American Catholicism, one that begins in Europe, and then another one that begins in Africa. And certainly as you think about yourself as an American Catholic, have you ever felt like an outsider in your church, sort of knowing your family's history and knowing that they are very much a part of the earliest, you know, generations of American Catholics here in the United States?
Yeah, sometimes I have in my past been an outsider and also experienced the whole racism that's happened to me. I remember there are two specific incidents I remember when I was probably about 7 or 8 years old. I went to visit my grandmother down in Merlin, and in the church, the last three pews were for black people, and the rest of the churches were white. And I remember sitting there and being there in the church in the last pew, and a white family came in, and I had to get up and get in my seat because the white section was all crowded, and so but the white people could not stand. And there, it's like, you know, if it's my church, then I have just as much a right to be, you know, part as anyone else. And the other instance that was hard, and I remember, and I think the fact that I can remember and know the specifics means that it did impact me. If it didn't impact me, I would remember. But the other time I remember, it was in West Philadelphia at St. Agatha's Church at 38th Street Garden, and I was about third or fourth grade, and I was always small, like I was small. So I was always small, and when we went up to the communion rail, that, you know, it was the girls were on one side of the church, the boys were on the other side, but at the communion rail, I was standing on the step, because in those days it was
parishes did you belong to, and what sisters taught you at your various schools?
In first and second grade, and part of my life and part of my story is either I'm a first or I'm an only. And a lot of the things in my life, and it even goes to my birth. I'm an only child, so and my mother and father used to say they were so I'm one of them. But anyway. I went in first and second grade. My father was in the Navy, so he was out of town. My mother was working working outside of the home. So I lived with my grandfather, John Lee, the one that we'll probably talk about. But I went in first and second grade. I went to St. Ignatius.
About your grandfather. Certainly when I was in your aunt's file, much of the information actually was based on your grandfather. He was the first African American to receive the Vercelli Medal from the Archdiocese of Philadelphia. It seems that he was very prominent. He actually has a cultural center here in the city in West Philadelphia named for him. And what was really interesting is that I learned of the story of him in 1902. He was actually the first African-American permitted to play basketball in a Catholic league in a high school. And there's a wonderful story from 1902 when he is at Roman Catholic, where I guess some of the other members of the league sent a letter to the coach and basically told them that they would not be allowed to play in the league if they did not remove the Negro from the team. And interestingly enough, several of his teammates decided to boycott if Johnny Lee was not allowed to play in 1902 and the league backed off. And so it's a story that I think has been written about in the local newspaper, but I'm wondering, how did you know, when did you learn about your own grandfather's, his trials in the church, but also these moments in which the church did live up to its creed, and certainly those who stood up in the face of racism and certainly said that he is our brother and that we're going to play with him, and if we don't, and if he doesn't play, if Johnny Lee doesn't play right, we don't play.
Yeah, and that was true. They, even the captain, you know, said that if they he didn't play. And I learned some of it later, you know, from my aunt or from my grandfather, or hearing stories. One of the, as far as the team is concerned, the coach and his brother were uncle of one of the sisters of mercy, and she always told us, she would always say this story until the day she died, the story of how when she was a little girl growing up, that her, when Johnny Lee came to her house, she always had to get dressed up, and she had to be on her best behavior because Johnny Lee was coming to the house. And she would tell that story. But the other thing that I remember when I was in high school in 1955 was when my grandfather got the Richelli Award, which, as Shannon just said, is the first time that an African-American got the Richelli Award, which is given to Catholic men. It's like the Holy Name Society. The men would get an award for an outstanding, but the first African-American to get it was him. And it came from the Pope, but it was like out of the Archdiocese of Philly. And, you know, like, so I remember that part of it. And when, in 1955, when he got the Richelli Award, also at West Catholic, I was a junior at West Catholic, and they did a good thing that had my two aunts, because they went to West Catholic. And so the two of them and me as a junior, and then my grandfather, so, you know, like that part was there. But some of the history of the family I learned from other members, from my mom would tell me some things, then, you know, my grandparents and my aunt would do it. And then some of the other experiences are things that, you know, I experience because of being who I am.
Certainly. Well, thinking about your grandfather, and for those of you who've never seen the Lee Culture Center, it's on the west side of the lake, West Philadelphia today. Thinking about your aunt, so on the one hand, we have this great story of your grandfather and his teammates sort of standing up to racism. And at the turn of the 20th century, when we don't necessarily think about those things happening, it's that moment in which sort of segregation is becoming the law of the land. And yet, some 40 years later, when his two daughters, one in the case of your aunt, Sister Mary Pauley, who was playing, I guess, basketball for West Philadelphia, West Catholic, she herself received a similar letter that she was not allowed to travel with the team to Baltimore because Negroes at that time were not even allowed as spectators in the gym. And unlike, I guess it seems from her obituary at least, she said that unlike what happened to her father, none of her teammates stood up for her, and so she was not allowed to play, on top of the fact that when she decided to enter a religious life, she and her sister, they were not admitted into any communities in Philadelphia solely on the basis of race. How did you know that? I mean, it's a question that we'll probably come back to time and time again. It's the story of African-American Catholics negotiating the spiritual conundrum of a racially segregated church, but specifically because of your family. How did your family deal with those rejections, especially when they felt called to religious life, they wanted to serve in their hometown, and yet race became a barrier for them that unfortunately they were not able to overcome in the 1940s?
Mm-hmm. And, you know, part of it would be their faith, because I think for much of what we experience, it's our faith that keeps us, you know, there. And my aunts weren't allowed then, and then Sister Mary Paul, the youngest one, gave a presentation, and she said that in 1945, when she wanted to go into the convent, that all the communities in Philadelphia, no one would take her. And so they, and any woman, the reason why I became the first in Philadelphia to enter Philadelphia community is because all the people ahead of me were told to go to another community. And even in Philadelphia, the Blessed Sacrament Sisters, who were founded for Black and Native Americans, Catherine Drexel at that time would not take from Philadelphia, would not take a Black girl. The very first Black to enter the, a Native American to enter the Blessed Sacrament wasn't until the 50s, 54, 55. But they were always sent either to the Oblates in Baltimore or to the Handmaids or to the Holy Family. And it's hard, but I think for me, one of the things is if it's a calling from God and it's something that God is saying needs to happen, then you do it. And I know some of the sisters would say to me, and I did vocations work a lot, and people would say to me, well, I didn't encourage them to come into the community because I know that the sisters were bigoted and prejudiced. And my answer is, then you're saying that you're God because you're taking the place of God and denying them a way to enter. And so then it says to me, you know, like, if I'm not doing that, then it's saying I'm God, and it's denying the fact that, as we're told, that God gives you everything that you need. So I say, yeah, it was hard, and when I look back, I don't know why I did it. There are times when I don't know why I stay. But the grace of God is the thing that keeps me going. So, you know, how do those of us who have stayed, those of us who go through the struggles and who have been spit upon and who have been physically abused, how do we stay? It's because it's, if it's God's work, then we need to do that. I don't know if that does
that. No, that certainly answers the question. I guess knowing your family's history, knowing that history of the rejection that your aunts faced in the 1940s, what was it like then when you received the word that you would be admitted into the Religious Sisters of Mercy in 1956? First off, you're an only child. How did your parents respond to the fact that their only child wanted to go into religious life? How did they take that? Were they supportive? Did they attempt to discourage you? Can you talk about that experience at all?
Yeah. For my mother, it was fine because my mother had the two sisters. Her two younger sisters were sisters. So she was kind of okay with that. The other thing, and I'm not sure you know this, her second oldest brother is in the seminary. The SVDs. He was in the seminary, but his mother got sick, and in those days, religious could not leave and go back in. Like, they couldn't come home and take care of their parents and go back in. Nowadays, that's, you know, it's an option that you can take care of your parents and still be in religious life. But in those days, they didn't. And so he left to take care of his mother, who was very sick, who really died, you know, shortly after. But he came out of seminary, but I don't know if you know this part, the showing the faith, I'm told that he is one of the ones who really started and really promoted the Crescia movement in Pennsylvania, that it started back then. And he, you know, was the Crescia movement is like a, in the, what we have called, I guess, a charismatic movement, but it was a movement that really dealt with the Christianity and what we should be as Christians. But that he did that, so you know that was part of it. But my mother was fine with it. My father was not as fine with it because he was not a cradle Catholic. He was a convert. But my father always said to me to be the best of what I could be. And that also is one of the things that has helped me through life. Because I had to study, I knew that I was living in a society where I had to be double standard. I had to be better than the people I was with. So I had to always exceed, I had to always do that. So, but my father was not as happy because in the 50s, the whole thing was for black women to, you know, get married, have children, and continue, especially after the war when all the, you know, the men. And so he was not real happy, but he wouldn't stop me from entering. And I was telling Shannon that at the time when he died, my mother had the wallet, and in his wallet, the only picture that he had in his wallet was a picture of me in the old habit. So even though he was not really happy, but I always could come home, the door was always open for me to come home. When we could get the key to the house, I had a key to the house, I could come in anytime. But he was, even though he was not saying he was happy, underneath he was kind of proud.
Thank you. Can you say a little bit more about the weight of being the first? Certainly when we hear the stories of, you know, racial pioneering or gender pioneering in the United States, you know, the plight of the first is not easy. Did you have a sense of, in 1956, what that meant for you to be the first? In your community, the first from Philadelphia to be permitted to come into a community. What was that like? Certainly we know the stories of some of the other pioneering black sisters. What was your specific story in sort of your thought process in the 1950s, and you know, can you reflect on it now differently in the 21st century?
It's one of those things, if I knew that, I knew that. Some of it, I was so young, because I was 17 when I entered. 17. And, so part of that was there. But I think the model of my two aunts ahead of me. So that was a lot of the inspiration of what I had. And it's funny because it was also, for me, it was the Sisters of Mercy. Because in high school, I was taught by seven different communities. There are seven different communities of women, but it was the spirit, and for me, the whole encouragement and the life of what I saw as a Sister of Mercy that encouraged me to go into mercy. So that was there. But I think that, and part of it was being with friends, like, I remember the decision to go into the Mercies at that year. I was going to go to college for music, and I had everything signed up and everything. But it was a birthday party of one of the girls who was going into the Mercies, and in those days we had to bring trunks with all our stuff in it. And at the I think part of it also is the encouragement and the fact of seeing and being involved and dialogue that helped for me to go at that particular time. But you know, like a 17-year-old, I don't know that I knew or thought about all the repercussions and the things. And that's what happens now. Sometimes the things that I do and the rejections and things that happen to me, it is only after it happens and then I look back on either the way that I dealt with it, that I learn from it. You know, I think that that's, you know, what happens is sometimes. I don't know, does that...
And it certainly does. I'm thinking about the Religious Sisters of Mercy in particular because, you know, I've been given access by your community to actually sort of look at the behind the scenes of the decisions that were being made when they decided to break the barrier, when they did it in various parts of the country. And I'm curious, did you realize, though, even if you weren't necessarily cognizant of sort of the weight of what you were doing, were there things that were done that you can look back on now that saying, you know, perhaps they were in many ways attempting to warn me that it would be difficult, especially just thinking about, I know with the interview you said that there was a different interview process than from your for your counterparts. Can you say a little bit more about that?
What I have found out since then, when I, in 1956, I had to go to Marion 3 times and be interviewed. And I found out later that other sisters I knew with, they didn't. I also, the 3rd time I went, my parents had to be with me. And they got interviewed. And I found out, like some of the sisters, even after me, that didn't happen. One of the times, one of the interviews that I went, and the sister, the vocation person, she told me that I was the first African American to be wanting to come. And I think she told me that, and you know, like, and I know her afterwards, when she told me that, it wasn't a sense of trying to discourage me. I didn't feel that. I felt it was a sense of her telling me the reality of the situation, that there was nobody ahead of me, and, you know, that I wouldn't have anybody with me at that time, another person of color. So, you know, that was part of, you know, where it was coming from.
And so can you speak about the administration, because you said that you were in a line of first in the mercies under the administration of mm-hmm. the superior. So you come in 1956, but in the 40s they had also begun to break some other barriers. Mm-hmm. Can you speak a little bit more about that and that superior?
Yeah, the Sisters of Mercy were founded in Ireland, and we, you know, came into the United States in the 1830s, and Philadelphia, we came in 1861, we came to Assumption. But in the Sisters of Mercy, in Marion, the Marion Sisters of Mercy, in before 1945, the only sisters, the only women in the Sisters of Mercy were either Irish background, and we had about 14 or 15 German. Those were the only 2 ethnicities that were in the Sisters of Mercy up until 1945. When Mother Bernard Graham was her last name, and those of you in Philadelphia know about Bishop Graham. Bishop Graham was Mother Bernard's brother. But when Mother Bernard became the Superior General, it was under her that the first Italian came into the mercies, the first Lebanese. Any other ethnicity came in after when she, after her. So I was in 56, so, and she was in, and then she was like a, in those years, you were in for 6 years, and then you could be elected, and then you might come out, and then, you know, like the, those terms have changed, but it was Mother Bernard who, that is the person that really started and really encouraged and really took the to do what needed to be done. And she's also the one that sent me to Levittown.
We'll come to Levittown, isn't it? So thinking about it, and so this is actually sort of the next year after your entrance day with your father and your grandfather. So your grandfather was well aware of you going into religious life. He was present. Was he also present at your entrance day as well as the...
No.
Okay, but he was there the next year when you were admitted into the community formally. So thinking about those sisters, young men and women who desegregated convents and seminaries, oftentimes they weren't simply desegregating those spaces. They oftentimes went on to desegregate parish schools and parishes and beyond. And so certainly your story doesn't stop in Marion. It goes throughout Pennsylvania and then Texas and Virginia and beyond. And so I know one of your earliest assignments was actually being sent to St. Michael of the Archangel in Levittown in 1961. Now, for those of you who are not aware of Levittown, in 1957, when that suburban community, I guess, allowed the first African-American family to purchase a home, the community revolted. I think it's the best way to respond. It sort of caused and remembered Levittown as one of the nation's sort of premier suburbs. And initially at that time, African-Americans, whether or not they had the financial resources, African Americans attempting to use their GI benefits were not allowed to purchase homes in those spaces. They were denied loans solely on the basis of race. And so when the first African American family moves into Levittown, William and Daisy Myers and their three children, the community does revolt, forcing the National Guard to come in to protect the family from their neighbors, who we can say wage a several days long terror campaign against them, oftentimes sort of standing out of their home, sort of attempting to get them to leave. They stay for 4 years. And then in 1961, they decide to leave after several other African-American families come in, but they also themselves are victims and subjected to horrific sort of terror from their neighbors. And in 1961, when the Myers leave, I think you said in March of 1961, a cross was burned on the home of an African-American family. And then a couple of weeks later, you received orders that you were going to St. Michael.
Yeah, in March 1961, the cross was burned in the home of a black family. And in August of 1961, I got sent to Levittown. Now, it's only in the last 4 or 5 years I was talking to one of the sisters of Mercy. We were talking, and I'm on the anti-racism team for the Sisters of Mercy, so, you know, I go around talking and anti-racism. But Sister said to me that her father told her that in 1961, when the pastor at St. Michael's found out that I was coming, he called a meeting of all the men in the parish and told the men that I was coming, and that if anything happened or any person didn't agree with it, they would be put out of the church. So for me to hear that was it was encouraging for me, because it means that back in 1961, there was a person of the church who was willing to stand up and go for the right thing rather than to let the wrong thing continue.
So can you talk about your time at St. Michael's? You were there for 3 years.
I was there for 3 years. The thing that I love to tell that in today's educational system would never happen is the first year I was at Levittown, I had 100 first graders by myself with no teacher's aid. And the second year I had 100. They were in Levittown. At that time, in 61, 62, I think it was the largest Catholic elementary school in the Archdiocese of Philly. And so, you know, that was there. I never had any trouble with the children, which happens a lot of times when you hear people say, could walk across and be in Bristol. So it was that close, but I don't remember a lot of Black. Did that sound?
Yes, thank you. So moving forward to 1968, so King is assassinated in April, on April 4th, 1968. And we know that the nation's Black priests gather in Detroit to respond not only to King's assassination, but also to the reports that were coming out of Chicago that those who were participating in the uprisings, that there were police orders to shoot to kill. And so there was a great concern on the part of the church of being a living witness, but also those within the church who wanted the church to reckon with its own complicity in the story of American racism. So we know the priests go to Detroit in 1968, and there's actually one Black nun who's there, who is Pittsburgh's first religious Sister of Mercy, and she's there and she's not allowed to join the priests, but she is encouraged to join and to gather the nation's Black sisters. And so she comes back to Pittsburgh, gains the support of the Bishop of Pittsburgh, and sends a letter to all the Superior Generals in the United States asking them to send their Black members to a gathering in Pittsburgh in August at Mount Mercy College. Do you recall sort of that moment when you received word from your community that they were gathering the Black sisters and your initial response to that call?
My initial response is I'm not going because I don't have, there's no racism, there's no prejudice. I'm not feeling that as a Sister of Mercy. So I say I'm not going. Well, the sister I told you about, the one that takes the first Italian, the first African, she was superior. I went. She sent the two. At that time, there were two African Americans. The other sister is still, she's missioned in Arizona. But the two of us went to Pittsburgh. And I'm so grateful I went. And it really changed my life. Because when I was there, I didn't have the personal experiences of racism necessarily, seeing it open and blatant. But I was there to hear a sister who had been in religious life for 17 years, and she was never educated. The only ministry she was ever given was to answer the door. I was there to hear and meet a sister who had been in the community for years, and then another sister, darker than him, wanted to enter, and she was not allowed to enter. And then they began to say that the sister was already here, who was Black. And during that week, Patty Gray, the Mercy Sister, the speakers that she had, I mean, she was a woman also before her time. But when I left that, I came back fired up. And I remember I came back. I used to straighten my hair in those days. In the 60s, I straightened my hair. I came back and I decided no more am I straightening my hair. So I had the biggest and one of the sisters that I had entered with,
her picture was on her
bed. She came up to me and said, I was a little different. What happened to you? I had to think, you know, that was so hurtful because she was my friend. I was in classes with her, and I was Catholic. But just because I changed my exterior, it was wrong. So when I came back, and I remember one of the, and I didn't tell you this, but
we're fine.
One of the things that also happened, when I came back, I didn't learn to drive, and didn't drive until I was 42 years old. But, no, that was yesterday. When I came back, the Church of the Advocate, I don't know if any of you know, the Church of the Advocate is like in North Philly. And the historical fact is, the Church of the Advocate is the church where the first Episcopal But the thing that happened was the speaker did not get there, and it was like about 8:30, and in those days, the good holy nun had to be in the convent, so I couldn't stay to hear the speaker. But I remember going and being willing and wanting to be there, because having been to the Black Sisters Conference, it was a challenge that I, as a Black woman religious, needed to be in ministry with my people. And I needed to be and know and feel and experience what my people were going through.
So then coming back from the National Black Sisters Conference then in 1968. So for those of you who want to see Sister Cora Marie's afro, this is her with her dinner with her hair.
That's
in December.
That's not as big as I
And then soon thereafter, you come back to your alma mater, West Philadelphia Catholic Girls' School. And can you talk about who the new Sister Cora Marie was and what you did at West Philadelphia Catholic Girls' School in terms of the kinds of ministries that you began to take up in terms of curriculum development and beyond?
In 1969, I had sent by the same Mother Hermann, got sent to West Catholic, and so I became the first African-American woman religious to be in the Catholic school, high school system. I was there from 69 to 76. During that time, I started the Black Studies Club, which was a cultural, they learned poetry, they learned all about Black history, and all the things that weren't being taught in school. I also was so feeling I had to. I also went to Hallahan and I helped start the school, the Black Studies there. I also took the bus, because I wasn't driving, so I also took the bus and did it up at Little Flower. I did that. So I did that, the Black Studies Club, and really started that. And it's still now, it's still continuing that kind of emphasis on Black Studies. One of the people, and this is the thing that really for me says what I need to continue and to happen. One of the people that I taught and one of the people that was one of the leaders of the Black Studies Club was Mona Africa. I don't know if any of you remember the whole, those of you from Philadelphia know about the moon and the fire and all. And Mona Africa is the only adult that lived through the fire and the bombing that Mayor Wood did. And I'm going through things to try to get things together. And I found a letter I had written to Mona, and after all that, and I found a letter that Mona wrote to me. So I had a letter from Mona telling me what it had meant to her, and just saying what we shared. And so that's something that I have as a memory of things.
Thank you. I think I want to ask one question, and I want to give us some time to open up to the audience. And I think I want to go ahead and move to your time in Virginia and to talk about your ministry, not only at Virginia State, but how you come to become the first Black sister who was appointed to serve as a pastoral administrator at St. Elizabeth Catholic Church in 1990. Mm-hmm. Most people don't know, Sister Cora Marie was actually a Jeopardy answer. So I guess when she was appointed to this historic role, like there was a Jeopardy question. And so she didn't see the episode, but I'm going to find it for you and send it to you. But can you talk about your time in Virginia where you've been stationed for the past?
I was in charge of a program here in Philly, and as they say, many times that God closes one door and opens another. So I was in charge of a program here in Philadelphia, and things did not work, and I resigned from it. And so the resignation was when I got sent to Virginia. And down in Virginia, I went down as a campus minister. resident priest, and Bishop Sullivan, who was the bishop at that time, asked if I would be the head of that church. And we were there were nine of us, nine lay people, who were pastors of churches in the diocese of Richmond at one time. And I tell people, because when you say that, people automatically assume that all of us were sisters. One of the women who founded one of the churches was a mother of 12 children, and she founded St. Olaf's in the diocese. Another woman had 8 children, and she was the head of a church in Blackstone and Mahare and Crewe. But it wasn't just sisters that were in charge. We chose our name, and we were called pastoral coordinators, but we were responsible for the church. And I used to laugh and be able to say that I lived in a rectory. I was a pastor, so I lived in a rectory. So I did that, and that was for 14 years. And really, it's one of the ministries that I really loved and focused. It challenged me, but it also was one of the times that I really felt the pressure of one of the things in the church that was difficult, and that is the ordination of women. And it was really difficult too, because one of the nights I got a call that one of my parishioners, a young teenager, was shot. And the family called me to come, and I went to the hospital. And as I'm driving to the hospital, I think, oh, I didn't stop to get the oils to anoint me. But I couldn't do that. But the grateful thing is that the priest who was there, when he anointed him, he let me also, you know, be part of that whole blessing. But that was another tough time, because there are times in our lives, all of our lives, there are times when we want to do something, but because of systems or things that are happening, we can't do it. So I did that I was a pastor for 14 years, very rewarding. And then the last thing I did in ministry I worked for the state, and that was a challenge, and the community had to really look at that, because when you're working for the state, there are some things that you have to look at and be careful of.
And what was your position with the state?
The state, I was the deputy director for the Human Rights Council of the state of Virginia.
So I did want to open it up to the audience. If there are any questions in the audience, please do stand up and project. And if I can come to you, if you have any questions for Sister Cora Marie about any of her time in religious life, her journey, that of her family, whatever she can remember. Any questions for Sister Cora Marie?
Thank you.
Does that answer your question?
She's asking, does that answer your question? She's asking, does that answer your question?
Yes, it does.
Thank you. Thank you.
What's happening right in Virginia? Can
Anyway, for me, I feel there's hope. And also for me, it's faith and living up to the faith. And what I feel is that all of us together, we each have a different gift. We each have something that we need to add of ourselves to the bigger picture. We can no longer say that they should do it or they did it. It has to be the we. We, I, have to be involved. So for me, I look at my gifts, and sometimes that gift might be to say something. One time that gift may be to challenge, or sometimes I need to just step back and not say something. But I feel that there is hope. And I feel that the more I look within myself and say that I need to do something, if I see something